The role of cannabis is best documented in the holy anointing chrism and sacred incense of Judaism, as prescribed in Exodus of the Old Testament. It contains a huge quantity of a so-called fragrant cane designated as cannabosum. This has been correctly identified now for almost a century as the assimilation into Hebrew of the Scythian plant that in Greek is rendered as cannabis.
Let me state right at the outset that I think it's absolutely clear that cannabis was in the Holy Land. We have archaeological proof dated to the 4th century. There was this carbonized fragment of cannabis that was found in a cave on Bet Shemesh in Israel. Mm-hmm. Additionally, I firmly believe that cannabosum in the Hebrew was cannabis. Mm-hmm. So I'm absolutely convinced it was there. You know, as mentioned in Exodus, that cannabosum was part of the holy anointing oil, mm-hmm. also used as an incense. Mm-hmm. And it really makes sense.
Priests of Israel being directly connected to the resinous elements of the cannabis plant, which are the psychoactive parts, it's actually irrefutable.
Time that Moses is to speak to the Lord, he goes into this enclosure called the tent of the meeting. He covers himself in this oil, and THC, the active ingredient in cannabis, is fatty soluble and can pass through the skin. And he places some of this oil on the incense altar, he burns it, and he speaks to the Lord in the pillar of smoke over the incense altar.
Hotboxing for thousands and thousands of years before religion. That's right, since we are a nomadic people, we've always been smoking cannabis.
In this show, we're going to be taking a look at some very interesting references to cannabis that are alleged to appear in the original Hebrew text that made up the Old Testament. My name is Chris Bennett, and I've been researching the role of cannabis in a variety of different religions for over 20 years. And in this episode, I'm going to be joined by people like Professor Carl Ruck, the words of Dr. Ethan Russo, and others to take a look at these fascinating references discovered by the Polish anthropologist Sula Bennett. Sula Bennett, also known as Sarah Benetowa, lived from 1903 to 1982. She was a Polish anthropologist who studied Polish and Judaic customs and traditions. One part of Bennett's writing which has attracted some modern attention is her claim that the herb known as cannabosum, mentioned in the Hebrew Bible, may relate to the religious use of cannabis. As Sula Bennett herself noted,
in the original Hebrew text of the Old Testament, there are references to hemp both as incense, which was an integral part of religious celebration, and as an intoxicant.
Through comparative etymological study, Bennett documented that in the Old Testament and its Aramaic translation, the Targum Onkelos, hemp is referred to as cannabosum, and is also rendered in traditional Hebrew as cannabos and cannabus.
Hebrew, of course, only records the consonants, and you have to decide how you're going to vocalize them. But cannabosum is a very good approximation to cannabis.
In many ancient languages, including Hebrew, the root can has a double meaning, both hemp and reed.
Well, bosom means aromatic.
In the course of time, the two words canna and bosom were fused into one. Cannabos, or cannabus, known to us from Mishnah, the body of traditional Hebrew law.
Cannabosum has been for a century now recognized as really cannabis. It occurs in the Bible, in Exodus, in the recipe for the holy anointing oil and the holy incense, and it contains huge amounts of cannabosum.
According to Sula Bennett, the word cannabossum was mistranslated as calamus, a common marsh plant with little monetary value that does not have the qualities or value ascribed to cannabossum. This error, she believes, occurred in the oldest Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible, the Septuagint.
In many translations of the Bible's original Hebrew, we find cannabossum, variously and erroneously, translated as calamus, an aromatic reed, a vague term.
It's translated as fragrant cane or calamus, only because translators really don't care about plants, but it's cannabis.
The error occurred in the oldest Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible, Septuagint, in the 3rd century BC, where the terms canna, cannabosum, were incorrectly translated as calamus. And in the many translations that followed, including Martin Luther's, the same error was repeated.
In the earliest translations, from the Hebrew into the Greek, in the Septuagint, it was mistranslated as calamus, and then subsequent translations ever since then have not gone back to the Hebrew, but have gone, in fact, to the Greek and have propagated this misconception that calamus is the plant that was used in this anointing oil of the priest.
Other references to canna in the Old Testament's original Hebrew and elsewhere make it abundantly clear that this is a designation to a plant that could be made into an incense, a topical oil, as well as a fiber and food source.
Another piece of evidence regarding the use of the word canna in the sense of hemp rather than reed among the Hebrews is the religious requirement that the dead be buried in canna shirts. Centuries later, linen was substituted for hemp.
Linguist Burgess Shale points to a number of references in the Old Testament that clearly indicate canna as a fiber source, such as the reference in Ezekiel 43 to the prophet's vision of a man holding a line of flax and a measuring reed, actually designating a hemp rope and stalk used as measuring tools, and as held in depiction of Assyrian rulers and deities, who we'll be discussing shortly for their connection to cannabis incenses and topical oils. Canna appears in another vision in Genesis 41:22, where it is translated as a stalk that has 7 heads of grain coming from it, which would definitely not be possible for calamus. Cannabis has been seen as a grain and was considered one of the 7 main grains in ancient China. According to the rabbi Emmanuel Lowe in his German book, Die Flora der Juden, medieval Jews ate the nutritious hemp seed in a delicacy known as tzilik. The first part of the word means roasted, while the final k designating canna as hemp. And in this designation, Rabbi Lowe, in a way, gave independent support for Sula Bennett's linguistic identification, although Lowe did not place it in the context of biblical verse and just referred to the term canna as hemp. According to Lowe, the biblical Jews of the Persian period adopted a name for cannabis, sahadanag, which means royal grain, as a name for a hemp seed preparation that was generally served in the form of a heart-shaped cookie. Interestingly, Lowe also made reference to hashish prepared into a Jewish Passover wine concoction and as an incense, as shall be discussed later. The evidence for canna being hemp has become so strong in recent years that even the mainstream internet religious study site Navigating the Bible, touted as the online bar mitzvah tutor, acknowledges that the Hebrew word cannabossum or fragrant cane of Exodus 30:23 is viewed by some translators as a reference to sweet calamus. Some scholars dispute this and suggest that cannabossum is a reference to the hemp plant. Bennett's research has also been pointed to by a number of other researchers. The anthropologist Vera Rubin noted that cannabis appears in the Old Testament because of the ritual and sacred aspect of it. In 1980, the respected anthropologist Weston LaBarre referred to the biblical references in an essay on cannabis, concurring with Bennett's earlier hypothesis. In that same year, respected British journal New Scientist also ran a story that referred to the old Hebrew Testament references, stating that linguistic evidence indicates that in the original Hebrew and Aramaic translations of the Old Testament, the holy oil which God directed Moses to make, Exodus 30:23, was composed of myrrh, cinnamon, cannabis, and cassia. And Rabbi Ari Kaplan, a late noted American Orthodox rabbi and author, in the Living Torah, notes that on the basis of cognate pronunciation and a Septuagint reading, some identify cannabossum with the English and Greek cannabis, the hemp plant. In regards to Kaplan's comments about the cognate similarities between cannabossum and cannabis, I would say that this goes much further than the similarity in name sounding, and there's much more evidence for cannabossum being cannabis. And one of the things that's really important in this discussion will be taking a look at the contemporary ancient Assyrian references to cannabis and how indications there are that it was used in a very similar way here as to what Sula Bennett suggested for the cannabossum. In ancient Mesopotamia, cannabis was used both medicinally, and oils and incenses were prepared from the plant because its aroma was pleasing to the gods. In the second quarter of the first millennium BC, the word kanabu begins to turn up as a source of oil, fiber, and medicine. And in our own time, numerous scholars have come to acknowledge kanabu as an early reference to cannabis.
And by all accounts, cannabis was a very, very important plant to the Assyrians in Babylon. They used it for fiber, they used it for food oil, they used it for cannabis incense, cannabis ointments, even cannabis delectables.
Recipes for cannabis incense, regarded as copies of much older versions, were found in the cuneiform library of the legendary Assyrian king Ashurbanipal. And records from the time of his father Esarhaddon indicate that cannabis was one of the main ingredients of the sacred rites. In a letter written in 680 BC to the mother of the Assyrian king Esarhaddon, references made to kanabu. And in response to the mother's questions, what is used in the sacred rites, a high priest responded that the main items for the rites are oils, water, honey, odorous plants, and kanabu, cannabis.
Yeah, and here we see a depiction of King Esarhaddon, and he's heading into what is an incense tent. There's a thing there with some curtains over it, and they would burn incense inside this tent and put their head inside of it, inhale the fumes. All of this, of course, was done with religious connotation.
And cannabis was not only used as an incense, interestingly, in these references, but also as a topical lotion. And an Assyrian medical tablet from the Louvre collection has been translated as, so that God and man should be in good rapport with hellebore, cannabis, and lupine, you will rub him. So a fascinating, you know, parallel here with what we're suggesting of cannabis incenses and cannabis ointments. Here in contemporary Assyrian references, it was used that way in the inner temple with the high priests and kings in much the same way as what we're suggesting for these Hebrew references. Bennett believed that although the word was generally thought to be of Scythian origin, it showed up much earlier in the original Semitic languages like Hebrew. However, myself and also Professor Carl Ruck disagree with that view and see the term cannabossum as the adoption of the common Indo-European term for cannabis, kana, taken into the Hebrew lexicon as an item of trade, and it came to the Hebrews as an item of trade according to some of these references.
Dantes and Greeks from Uzal brought your merchandise. They exchanged wrought iron, cassia, and canna for your wares.
As Professor Carl Ruck explains in regards to the etymology of cannabis,
the word cannabis is a Greek assimilation of the Scythian word, and other cultures have assimilated as well The Hebrew version of it is Kana Bosom.
The word bears an unmistakable similarity to the Scythian cannabis. Is it too far-fetched to assume that the Semitic word cannabosum and the Scythian word cannabis mean the same thing?
The use of an Indo-European word in Semitic language shows that the ritual use of cannabis came to the Hebrews from a foreign source, and as an item of trade, likely via the Scythians, who are known to have spread the term canna around much of the ancient world, with established trade routes reaching through the Mideast into India, China, and Europe. As an item of trade, cannabis retained the core aspect of its original name in the different areas where it arrived.
There is evidence of the presence of the Scythians in Palestine. The importance of the geographical position of Palestine cannot be overlooked when considering the trade routes through which caravans moved, laden with goods and precious spices. Rostovzeff describes the caravan trade between Babylonia, Egypt, Syria, and Asia Minor. Among the goods, there was incense for the delection of gods and men.
Now, interestingly, these Scythians were known to have used cannabis.
You probably will recognize these little figures.
Scythians.
Scythians. Now, you may know some history about that in cannabis, I'm sure.
Well, here we are back with Herodotus, who is the first one of the Greeks to tell the story of the Scythians. He tells the story that they would erect a small tent based on Herodotus says three stakes, but the ones that they dug up in Pazaric are six stakes. So it was about 3 or 4 feet tall. It would be covered with a piece of felt or possibly hemp cloth, and there would be a little opening in the cloth. Inside this tent, they would put a cauldron. In the cauldron, they would put red-hot stones, and on top of the stones, or sometimes I've read on that the hemp was thrown in first, and then the red-hot stones added. And out came, according to Herodotus, such a vapor that it far exceeded any Greek vapor bath, and they would howl for joy. It's a wonderful passage.
I'm the Meat Guy, and today we're doing the pop-up tent hotbox. Man has been hotboxing for thousands and thousands of years before religion. That's right, since we are a nomadic people, we've always been smoking cannabis. It's like a crazy toke every time you breathe in. Oh my god, and I'm like at the top of the roof, so you know it's gathering up here. This is intense. I'm like in another planet. I feel like I'm in a cloud. Expect that. I was going to another planet, that's for sure. Stay safe and stay friendly with all your neighbors, alright? Love life, enjoy it, alright? Woo!
When Herodotus is describing the Scythian fumigation tent ritual, he compares the way the Scythians come out of the tent howling with the same kind of intoxication that wine induces.
Herodotus described the Scythian ritual, and this was thought to be largely mythological until in the 20th century when some Soviet archaeologists, Professor Rudenko, came across some Scythian tombs and actually found the makings of a small teepee-like tent structure that was placed over a cauldron that he found that had rocks in it that had burnt cannabis seeds in it, and shows that the Scythians were in fact, you know, throwing down cannabis on hot rocks and inhaling the vapors and capturing these vapors inside the little tent.
The Scythians participated in both trade and wars alongside the ancient Semites for at least one millennium before Herodotus encountered them in the 5th century BC.
As we shall see in the story of Moses, this is a very similar way to how Moses related to Yahweh with the Kenabosim in what is now the Tent of the Meeting, a little enclosed space that contained a lot of smoke.
God, who ironically appears to Moses in flames of fire from within a burning bush, commands Moses to make this holy anointing oil with about 9 pounds of this Kenabosim, which is sometimes translated as fragrant crane, sometimes translated as calamus, mixed with myrrh and cinnamon into about 1.5 gallons of olive oil.
Then the Lord said to Moses, take the following fine spices, 500 shekels of liquid myrrh, half as much of fragrant cinnamon, 250 shekels of Kenabosim, 500 shekels of cassia, all according to the sanctuary shekel, and 1 hind of olive oil. Make these into a sacred anointing oil, a fragrant blend, a work of a perfumer. It will be the sacred anointing oil. Anoint Aaron and his sons and consecrate them so that they may serve me as priests.
Every time that Moses is to speak to the Lord, he goes into this enclosure called the Tent of the Meeting. He covers himself in this oil, and THC, the active ingredient in cannabis, is fatty soluble and can pass through the skin.
In the tabernacle where you spoke with God, everything was anointed with this oil, which contained cannabis amongst other things. And in the ordination of the priest, the priest was anointed with the oil. Many people are naive about how you can administer drugs, but it should be quite obvious that drugs are absorbed through the skin, otherwise those nicotine patches and so forth wouldn't work.
There's lots of references to psychoactive ointments containing cannabis and other substances throughout history, not only in Assyria and Babylonia, but in Canaan. Later on, we have medieval witches' ointments that contain cannabis in them, as well as 19th century occultists' astral traveling ointments that contain cannabis. So there's plenty of historical widespread references to the use of these types of oils.
Now, do you think that such a mixture would be medically effective?
Oh, I think it may well be.
You know, there's a lot of people using cannabis-enriched massage oils and for arthritic pain and stuff these days. And I have heard of accounts of people saying that they got high off of those.
Well, there's been a lot of controversy. There's actual, again, research being done. Audra Stinchcomb, Kentucky, was trying to... She had a grant from the National Cancer Institute, I believe it was, to look at transdermal application of THC. The thing is, though, that they only got to about 10% of the amount in that they needed to have a big effect. Now, again, that's different than using an oil, particularly if it's combined with other things.
Yeah.
You know that things like cassia and cinnamon actually increase blood flow, and it would be conceivable that that irritation from those ingredients would actually make it more likely that the THC in the preparation could get in through the skin. Mm-hmm. So I think that's entirely possible.
Health Canada has done tests on this, and I think it was with a 28% solution, they found 33% solubility.
We don't have to just look for Kenabosim references, but any reference to this anointing oil, this particular anointing oil, is going to contain that same recipe, and possibly the addition of mandrake and other plants, as mandrake appears in the book of Genesis. We are obviously aware of the very powerful psychoactive properties of mandrake, as well as the Song of Songs, which makes more reference to the anointing oil and indicates that mandrake, by that time at least, had been combined with Kenabosim.
As in many religions, its use was restricted to the Levites, the priestly caste.
Say to the Israelites, this is my most sacred anointing oil for the generations to come. Do not pour it on men's bodies, and do not make any oil with the same formula. It is sacred, and you are to consider it sacred. Whoever makes perfume like it, and whoever puts it on anyone other than a priest, must be cut off from his people.
Anybody who made such an anointing oil with cannabis in it, besides the priests, were going to be cut off from their people, which was pretty much a death sentence in the ancient world. You're either going to be being a slave for another culture, or if you had any wealth or anything, they just take it.
And, you know, again, it's this idea that's been prevalent in a lot of religions that certain members can use this substance, but the common person cannot.
The big dispute has to do with whether this easy access to the deity should be shared with the community, or whether it should be reserved for the shaman or the priest or the elite or the monarchy.
And then there came a time where the Israelites, which were at that time were a divided bunch of tribes, decided to come together under one king, and they called for a king, and the prophet Samuel decided, okay, they want a king, I'll find him a king. And one day a big Israelite named Saul is looking for his donkey, and he goes to see the prophet Samuel to see if the witch doctor that he is, he can locate the donkey for him. But Samuel lays a trip on Saul and said, oh, well, you know what? The Lord's going to anoint you king over his inheritance, and you're going to be king of the Israelites. And he puts the anointing oil on him, and he says, you will feel the Spirit of the Lord come upon you in great power. And here we see the whole role of set and setting. You know, we can imagine if we'd never tried any of these substances and the local witch doctor comes to us and lays it on us and says, oh, well, once you take this, you're going to feel the Spirit of the Lord coming on you. As soon as you feel that high, that would all be magnified by the scenario and trip that had been laid on you. And that's like the role of set and setting. In Saul's case, we can see this is particularly powerful because it says Saul begins to prophesy. Now, the word prophesize that the Hebrew translation is from is Nabai. In fact, there's like six different words that are translated as prophet, but they all mean different things. And Nabai means to act in an ecstatic or frenzied manner. So Saul's obviously overwhelmed with the experience, starting to freak out a little bit. That's kind of a classic example of set and setting. And every Judaic king up until about 300 or 400 BC had to go through this anointing ceremony, as well as every priest. This was obviously a very important thing, and it was how the Spirit of the Lord was brought into the ruler. Now, an interesting thing happens also in the story of Samuel is there may have been a situation where his son broke into the holy cannabis crop and got some and was almost going to be put to death for it. There's a story described by Dr. C. Crichton, who was writing in 1903, wrote an essay, Evidence of the Hashish Vice in the Old Testament. And he points to the story of Jonathan being in a field of what is called honeywood. And he sticks his staff into the honeywood, and he takes it to his mouth, and his eyes become enlightened. Well, there's no such thing as a honey that exudes from wood. And the word itself in Hebrew, Yagar Hadash, makes more reference to a sticky or resin that comes out of a wood. And Creighton speculated that these references to honeywood, there's a few of them in the Old Testament as well, were also further references to cannabis. When Jonathan tastes the honey, his eyes become enlightened, and they become enlightened in exactly the same way as Adam and Eve do after eating of the forbidden fruit of the tree of knowledge. So this again points to a psychoactive substance, you know.
You know, it's mentioned in Exodus that Cannabosum was part of the holy anointing oil, mm-hmm. also used as an incense, mm-hmm. And it really makes sense.
Use it to anoint the altar of incense.
But Moses also burnt some of this oil with the incense on top of the incense altar.
Incense in the ancient world was often a mix of herbs that was difficult to light on its own and required lighting oils like olive oil in order to be ignited. However, in the case of the holy anointing oil, which was poured on the incense, this was also a thick resinous cannabis extraction that not only added a fragrant scent, but obviously contained potent psychoactive properties that kept it in high demand. However, there is evidence that the incense itself contained cannabis. That the incense was believed to be imbued with similar magical properties to that of the anointing oil can be seen in the identical prohibitions placed over both. The same craftsman who made the holy oil was also in charge of making the incense. He made the holy anointing oil and the pure incense of sweet spices, according to the work of apothecary. That the ingredients listed formed only part of this formula for the temple incense is well known. The Jewish historian Josephus wrote that there were actually 13 elements, and the Talmud only named 11 plus salt and a secret herb, which was added to make the smoke rise in a vertical column before spreading outwards at the top, exactly the way smoke from a burning piece of hashish reacts and rises.
See, the smoke starts to build up in a little glass. Got enough smoke?
Moses Maimonides, a medieval Jewish philosopher, commented that the object of incense was to animate the spirits of the priests, which would again indicate an entheogenic preparation. Commenting on the word frankincense, which means pure incense, and which appears in the Exodus recipe for the holy incense, aromatherapy expert Suzanne Fischer-Riese noted that we once called all herbs burnt as incense frankincense, and this has long been noted by other scholars. Today, the word frankincense has come to specify the gum resin from the North African tree Boswellia, and aromatherapist Fischer-Riese points out that this modern source also contains psychoactive properties and is still used in churches to instill chemically induced feelings of religious awe.
Stuff that comes from Bactria, it's always adulterated with this other stuff over here. The Arabs substitute myrrh. You know what they do? When they'll take a drug, take the rub, basically the hashish, they'll take the rub of the plant, the finest point when that resin, when that THC resin is its most intense time, they'll take that, right, and sell it as a drug. Well, if your drug comes through the shipping through Arabia, they adulterate it. And what do they adulterate it with? Myrrh. So you end up with these combinations of plants that actually end up together. Oh, all of a sudden, myrrh and cannabis, you see them associated then more often. And they talk about this. Galen talks about which of these sleep, they call them sleep-inducing drugs. The consistency across all of these oracles is that, these sleep oracles, is that you go in there, you use these substances that you're given, and you have a dream oracle then. So this relaxes you, and you sit in the temple, and ultimately you have a dream oracle.
And Emmanuel Lowe says the incense itself contained cannabis under the name Hazaret Sarur, which means reverend essence, and that essence was a name for hashish in the ancient world.
Emmanuel Lowe referred to an ancient Jewish Passover recipe that called for wine to be mixed up with ground up saffron and hassasat sarur, which he saw as a kind of death name for the resin of cannabis sativa. Lowe suggests that this preparation was also made into a burnable and fragrant concoction by being combined with saffron and Arabic gum.
And Aaron shall burn incense every morning when he dresseth the lamps. He shall burn incense upon it. And when Aaron lighteth the lamps at even, he shall burn incense upon it, a perpetual incense before the Lord throughout your generation.
Cannabis was the ingredient in the incense that the high priest entered the enclosed tent, like the Scythian fumigation tent of the inner tabernacle. And in that enclosed space, he saw Yahweh materialize, doing the covenant with the deity, the highest sacrament of the religion. And it was induced by a vision accessed by cannabis.
There is no way that the concentrated fumigation with cannabis incense would not have been a psychoactive agent to access the materialized vision of the deity.
And he places some of this oil on the incense altar, he burns it, and he speaks to the Lord in the pillar of smoke over the incense altar. The pillar of smoke is actually referred to as the Shekinah in Hebrew and refers to the physical presence of God. So Moses is only talking to God when there is smoke pouring out of the tent of the meeting. So when you throw cannabis into that
scenario... You're saying Moses was a pothead, basically.
Yeah, well, basically I'm saying that Moses was like a shaman who, like shamans in South America and Africa, often ingest psychoactive plants and then interpret the experience they have from those psychoactive plants as some sort of spiritual revelation.
Right. They have no idea of receptor sites in the brains and chemicals or stuff. They felt that the experience that they received themselves was possession by the Spirit of the Lord in this case, and that the ideas they received in this transition were like divine inspiration. So Moses would go in puzzling on behalf of the Israelites, oh, we're hungry, what are we going to do? And then he'd take the anointing oil, and then he'd come back out and says, this is what the Lord your God says. Now, none of the other Israelites ever see the Lord or talk to the Lord, and they can only tell if Moses is talking to the Lord by the pillar of smoke over the incense altar.
I feel like I'm in a cloud.
The original religious experience was to share an identity with God, going back to the foundation of a culture which always involves the inspired experience of the founder, shaman, who goes to the other world and establishes the contract, the testament, the covenant upon which the civilization will depend for its relationships with the deity.
The anthropologist Weston LaBarre noted that Moses is a visionary shaman in whom the god, imperious id of the Vedic, repeatedly speaks. Psychologically, Moses and Yahweh are one. Magic power derived from Yahweh on direct instruction and contact is Moses' strength. We only need to remember what the burning bush said to Moses upon their meeting to understand the source of this inspiration in this relationship.
God said to Moses, I am that I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you.
And for generations after, priests of the temple utilized the oils and incense the burning bush commanded Moses to make, and through which they talk to their God, Yahweh, in a cloud of smoke. This was a common relationship for temples throughout the ancient world, as the effects of cannabis and other psychoactive substances aided in bringing on the inspiration to priests and poets that was interpreted as the word of God.
I think that there's a natural affinity between
cannabis-induced altered state of consciousness and creative attributes of the human mind. Great many artists have embraced cannabis as a creative catalyst. Many writers have benefited from the associational fluidity that cannabis engenders, its ability to unleash the spoken word, loosen the powers of analogy. Before the written word, there is the spoken word. Before literature, there is song. And there's a great many cultural reference points for cannabis as a speech-inducing agent in many different cultures, even in different cultures such as Central American Indian cultures, actually refer to cannabis, which they use in a ceremonial context, as the herb which makes one speak. India, ancient India, Tibet as well, referred to cannabis as an herb that impels the flow of words. So there's a natural affinity for literature there. And there's a biological basis for this. Cannabis dilates blood vessels, including blood vessels in the brain. The more the brain's blood vessels are dilated, the more blood will flow through the veins, the more oxygen that is in the brain, the more oxygen, the more thoughts, rush of thoughts. So there's a biological basis for that experience.
And when the smoke ran dry?
You have not brought any canna for me, or lavished on me the fat of your sacrifices, but you have burdened me with your sins and worried me with your offenses.
Fortunately for the prophet Isaiah, the altar of incense did not always run quite so dry.
And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth, and said, lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin is purged.
Those of us familiar with hashish know that it burns in a similar way to both incense and coal. It isn't hard to imagine an ancient shaman lifting a burning coal of hashish or pressed bud to the lips of the ancient prophet Isaiah. The style of administration used here is clearly reminiscent of what is called hot knifing, where two red-hot knives are pressed together over a small piece of hashish, releasing a burst of smoke to the mouth of the recipient. However, in the case of Isaiah, there is a definite tone of sanctity in the act, as upon having the coal lifted to his lips, he had his iniquity taken away and his sins purged. This is comparable to the way in which the Hindu sadhus lift the chilams to their third eye and exclaim, Boom Shiva, an act indicating their loss of ego and oneness with Shiva through their own use of this agent and sacred herb. This whole scenario is replayed somewhat in the story of Ezekiel, with what may be a reference to an edible cannabis preparation. The account in Ezekiel is amongst those suggested by Dr. C. Creighton in 1903 as evidence of hashish use in the Old Testament. Creighton believed that cannabis dipped in honey was a secret vice of the Hebrew temples and palace.
And he said to me, Son of man, eat what is before you. Eat this scroll, and then go to speak to the people of Israel. So I opened my mouth, and he gave me the scroll to eat. And then he said to me, Son of man, eat this scroll I am giving you, and fill your stomach with it. So I ate it, and it tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth. And then he said to me, Son of man, go now to the people and speak my words to them.
Referring to Creighton's research, Harvard Medical School professor Dr. Lester Grinspoon commented that the account in Ezekiel does sound like a description of an intense cannabis intoxication, an almost psychedelic experience.
The Spirit lifted me up, and I heard behind me a loud rumbling sound as the glory of the Lord rose from the place where it was standing. It was the sound of the wings of living creatures brushing against each other, and the sound of the wheels beside them, a loud rumbling sound. The Spirit then lifted me up and took me away, and I went in bitterness and in the anger of my spirit with the strong hand of the Lord on me.
It seems much more believable that the winged beings which appeared to Isaiah, Ezekiel, and other biblical prophets were not actual angels, but rather ancient shamans wearing elaborate costumes and enacting trance-inducing rituals, all enhanced by the use of cannabis smoke and likely a variety of other psychotropic compounds. And along with the smoke and flickering flames, they gave dead bronze, marble, and stone statues the appearance of animation and life. This type of ritual initiation was common in the ancient Middle East and often involved the use of winged costumes and masks, like those the early European explorers would find the aboriginal peoples of the world still using thousands of years later.
They would wear animal masks, and the wings represented the ability to travel between worlds and, well, in the psychoactive state.
From the description of cannabossum in Israel, Kanabu in Assyria, and cannabis amongst the Scythians, we can see that the resin of this plant was a very sought-after item, and these were far from the only ancient cultures competing for this rare and precious commodity. Thus, it is not at all surprising that quality incense claimed a price as high as gold in the ancient world. We can be sure that these various temples competed for access to cannabis incenses and oils specifically, as it helped fuel the sacred experiences these spaces were designed to engender. God's lament in Isaiah about not getting his due of canna.
You have not brought any canna for me, or lavished on me the fat of your sacrifices.
Was likely in part due to this, as at the time of its composition and for some centuries prior, there were temples of other deities competing with the priests of Yahweh for it, within Israel itself. The Old Testament makes reference to this rampant polytheism, and although the biblical account condemns it, for centuries it would seem polytheism had been the practice norm in the Holy Land.
Even hundreds of years after the Israelites rise from their Canaanite pagan roots, monotheism has still not completely taken hold.
This is awkward for some people, the notion that Israelite religion was not exclusively monotheistic, but we know now that it wasn't.
In fact, the prophets, holy men speaking in the name of God, consistently rail against breaking the covenant made with Moses to worship only Yahweh.
The Old Testament prophets are particularly incensed with the popularity of a goddess referred to as the Queen of Heaven, and identified as the Canaanite goddess Asherah, who for long periods of time is believed to have been coupled with Yahweh, and according to the Old Testament account, even worshipped alongside him in the temple itself.
The ancient Canaanites and later Hebrews paid particular reverence to a Near Eastern goddess known by the name Asherah, whose cult was particularly focused around the use of hemp.
The Bible admits the Israelites continue to worship Asherah and other Canaanite gods.
According to the Bible, the ancient worshippers of Asherah and the great goddess under various manifestation included wise Solomon and other biblical kings, as well as their wives and other daughters of Jerusalem.
At Tel Rehov, archaeologists are digging at an Israelite house that illuminates the religious practices of its ancient inhabitants.
Well, we just found this beautiful, exceptional clay figurine showing a goddess, a fertility goddess, that was worshipped here in Israel. Here, in this case, she's shown holding a baby.
Who is this fertility goddess? And what is a pagan idol doing in an Israelite home? Dramatic evidence as to her possible identity first surfaced in 1968. Bill Deaver was carrying out salvage excavations in tombs in southern Israel when a local brought him an inscription that had been robbed from one of them.
When I got home and brushed it off, I thought I was going to have a heart attack. Executed in clear 8th century script. It's a tomb inscription. And it just gives the name of the deceased and says, "Blessed may X be by Yahweh." That's good biblical Hebrew. But it says by Yahweh and his Asherah. And Asherah is the name of the old Canaanite mother goddess.
More inscriptions associating Yahweh and Asherah have been discovered.
There is a classic Greek term, cannabeism, which means to smoke cannabis. Cannabeism frequently took the form of inhaling vapors from an incense burner, in which these resins were mixed with other resins, such as myrrh, balsam, frankincense, and perfumes. This is the manner of the shamanistic Asherah priestesses of pre-Reformation Jerusalem, who anointed their skins with a mixture, as well as burned it. William and Bowden.
And Solomon was continually lambasted in the Old Testament for worshiping on high and burning incense in the high places and following the goddesses of the Sidonians, Asherah, Astarte, and these different embodiments of the goddess.
When Solomon grew old, his wives swayed his heart to other gods, and he was not holy with Yahweh his God as his father David had been. Solomon became a follower of Astarte, the goddess of the Sidonians.
And his incense worship seems to have been tied with that.
Solomon loved Yahweh. He followed the precepts of David, his father, except that he offered sacrifice and incense on the high places.
Sula Bennett believed that it was here, amongst the worshippers of the goddess, that the cultist use of cannabis originated in the Near East.
Taking into account the matriarchal element of Semitic culture, one is led to believe that Asia Minor was the original point of expansion for both the society based on the matriarchal circle and the mass use of hashish.
Sula Bennett's suggestion that cannabis use in the Semitic world originated amongst the ancient worshippers of the goddess seems likely, although it is still not necessarily indicative of a Semitic origin, as she suggested. As Asherah herself was the Canaanite counterpart of a much older, originally foreign goddess. The late, respected Assyriologist Erica Reiner, who was a distinguished professor at the University of Chicago's Oriental Institute and editor of the Chicago Assyrian Dictionary, noted that the herb called Simashera aromatic of the goddess Ishtar, which is equated with the Akkadian kanabu, cannabis, may indeed conjure up an aphrodisiac through the association with Ishtara, goddess of love, and also calls to mind the plant called Kina Ishtar. Kina, of course, being almost phonetically identical with Canna.
Tell you that I used essential oil of hemp with cassia and cinnamon to make a mixture just to see what it smelled like, and it's really lovely.
However, in relation to the Indo-European identification of the word cannabis and its suggested adoption into the Hebrew lexicon, it is important to note that the goddess Ishtara, the prototype of the Canaanite goddess Asherah, Asherah, the word itself, is attested as a loanword into the Assyrian language, coming in around the 19th century BC. The name is from a Proto-Indo-European root meaning to bind, as in tie, and this term held both mundane and magical connotations. Its counterpart in Old Norse or Old High German, rope, which again brings to mind the fibrous qualities of her holy plant cannabis. Interestingly, an ancient symbol of the goddess Ishtar is said to have been a bundle of reeds, which one wonders was meant to originally signify a bundle of her holy hemp. This is a valuable piece of information when trying to understand the ritual practices and beliefs of ancient Mesopotamia, especially regarding the considerably widespread worship of the goddess under her various location names, such as Ishtar, Asherah, Asherah, Ninurta. As Dr. David Hillman explains, the worship of this goddess even penetrated into the Mediterranean basin, and where she went, her ancient sacred plant followed.
The myth of cannabis use in the Greek world is all about Ishtar, it's all about Aphrodite, it's all about Astarte. These are goddesses, mother goddesses, queen goddesses. They all have the same designations, they have the same epithets across language barriers. This is probably a way of preserving the culture within the myth. The myth becomes a matrix that holds scientific clues from the society, about the society that you're studying. And one of the scientific clues that we can look at is how they use specific drugs. We know what the culture is doing by looking at what specific drugs they're using. And what do we see? We see cannabis. So you may have people tell you that, yes, in fact, they were using cannabis as a drug in the ancient world, and isn't that interesting? They were obviously getting stoned and sitting in coffee shops. No, this is a drug that comes from the women, and their cannabis was an earth-healing entity for them. In Paphia, the temple burns 24 hours a day, every day of the year. That's its reputation. It's the one place in all of Greece that you can go and sit any time of the day or night in this vapor cloud of THC, marijuana. It's amazing.
This association was widespread and considerably ancient, as the continuous worship of the goddess under a variety of evolving and related names and images can be traced back far into the Stone Age.
As humanity made the transition from a nomadic hunter-gatherer into a pastoral agriculturist, much of the earlier focus on animal totems, humanity's oldest religious symbols, which were used to symbolically attract game, later became focused on the image of the great goddess Mother Earth and the proper worship of her so that the earth would bear its fruits. As the developing mind of humanity struggled to comprehend the patterns of order in the seemingly chaotic world around them, they perceived that all new life was given birth by the feminine. Quote, in the presence of birth, they were doubtful not merely about the father's identity, but about his existence. Sex relations occurred without pregnancy. Why should not pregnancy occur without sex relations? Women alone was the visible life bestower, end quote, Eric Newman. This primeval concept of the female as a sole creatrix of life gave rise to the Great Mother, and thus many of the most ancient surviving religious artifacts are images of the female form. Her millennia of worship and veneration lasted well into biblical times. It is believed that women, who acted as the gatherers in the early nomadic clan, were the first to recognize how the plants they collected propagated themselves, and this led to the development of agriculture. Quote, since the cultivation of plants was first undertaken by women, their importance in the social structure greatly increased, which in turn gave rise to the cult of the Mother Earth, end quote, Rafael Patai. Agriculture and an abundant harvest led to more settled communities, and in light of this, it is not at all surprising to find that most of the earliest civilizations were both matriarchally structured and agriculturally based. quote, as goddess of food-giving plants, herbs, and fruits, she numinously transforms these basic elements into intoxications and poisons. It is quite evident that the preparation and storage of food taught women the process of fermentation and the manufacture of intoxicants, and that as a gatherer and later preparer of herbs, plants, and fruits, she was the inventor and guardian of the first healing potions, medicines, and poisons. The goddess is therefore not only the queen of the ennobled fruit of the soil, but also of the spirit of the matter of transformation that is embodied in wine and other intoxicants. End quote, Eric Newman. Hemp's origins as an agricultural crop set down its roots during the matriarchal period. And because of this, there remain strong mythological ties between hemp and the goddess, which lasted throughout the Old Testament period.
In relation to this, it is important to note that Solomon's Song of Songs, where we find our next reference to Canna, is considered to be the Semitic version of the ancient Mideast hero's gamos, or sacred marriage, a fertility ritual which had been common in the area for some millennia, and in which the god and goddess were ritually married via variations of their earthly counterparts, be it a high priest and priestess, or king and queen. This divine union was believed through imitative magic to ensure the health and fertility of the kingdom and land.
The Song of Songs is probably the most beautiful piece of literature in the Bible.
Come with me from Lebanon, my bride. Come with me from Lebanon. Descend from the crest of Amana, from the top of Sinir, the summit of Hermon. How delightful is your love, my sister, my bride. How much more pleasing is your love than wine, and the fragrance of your ointment than any spice. The fragrance of your garments is like that of Lebanon. Your plants are an orchard of pomegranates with choice fruits, with henna and nard, nard and saffron, canna and cinnamon, with every kind of incense tree.
As cannabis is thought by many scholars to be humanity's first agricultural crop, and this is a fertility ritual that originated among agriculturally based people, the inclusion of cannabis in this rite was likely as ancient as the ceremony itself. The goddess's worshippers included female and male cult prostitutes, which can be identified with the male and female cult prostitutes in the Old Testament, the Quetishim, who at times penetrated into the temple itself. And she also had a sacred class of male transvestites, known as kuguras. The kuguras perform music for the goddess's pleasure, as well as fumigating her with incense of fragrant cane, as in Kanabu. Marvin Pope, in his translation and groundbreaking commentary on the Song of Songs, which identifies the fertility rite's origins of the Old Testament poem, notes of an ancient Hieros Gamos poem, Idin Dagon's Hymn to the Divine Bride Inanna, a name of Ishtar, in comparison with the Song of Songs. The expert singers sit before her on the ground, those who play the lyre, the harp, and the clappers. The kurugus who carry the spindle and the whip ease her mind with incense of sweet reeds. The sweet reed with which the goddess's inwards are soothed is presumably the same aromatic cane of Exodus 30:23 and the sweet cane of Jeremiah 6:20, Isaiah 43:24, Ezekiel 27:19, and simply the cane in Canticles 4:14, Canticles, of course, being another name of the Song of Songs. Now, these are exactly the references that Sula Bennett suggested were references to Canna. And it's unclear of whether Pope was aware of that. He picked these exact references, but he didn't make reference to Sula Bennett's work. And as well as Reiner's identification of the plant of Ishtar, Kanuabu, as cannabis, as a sacred plant and fragrant plant of the goddess. So, interesting connection there. As we have seen, Kanabu was one of the main ingredients in the Near Eastern sacred rites. We can be sure that the reference to how the fumes of the incense ease your mind identified the entheogenic properties of cannabis smoke. It was the fibers of this same plant which were richly weaved via the spindles held by our worshippers. The fragrant procession described in the ancient pagan hymn clearly recalls the columns of smoke and clouds of myrrh and frankincense which accompany Solomon's litter as it rises from the desert on steppe land surrounded by the 60 skilled swordsmen like the Kurgurus who accompany Inanna Ishtar.
On the night of the wedding, that there is a sacrament that Venus is involved in. And what happens that Venus does is you give symbolically to the girl who's getting married, you give her a jar of opium, okay? And you give her a jar of a resin, an offering for her to give to Aphrodite. And these offerings all have cannabis in them. Okay, so the stuff is all over the place. And so you could stand back and look at the substances and say, what are they doing? What are these things doing? So the girl on this night, she goes in the oracle and she burns the incense and she goes through the ritual purification. And all of this stuff has the THC in it, all of it.
So what happened to cannabis in the Old Testament? How did it disappear? From what the Old Testament tells us, it's likely that Israel's slide into monotheism and the eventual disfavor of cannabossum took place via the alleged discovery of the Book of Deuteronomy inside the Temple of Solomon, sometime around 620 BC by a high priest named Hilkiah during the reign of King Josiah. At this time, both the southern kingdom of Judah and the northern kingdom of Israel were vassals of the Assyrians, a situation that likely explains the blatant Assyrian influence on the Hebrews of the time, such as the comparable use of cannabis to cannabossum for inducing religious experiences of the priests and royalty in both cultures. As this was particularly the time of the reigns of Ashurbanipal and Esarhaddon, whose own ritual use of cannabis was discussed earlier. Although attributed to Moses, Deuteronomy is written in a much later style of Hebrew and is largely thought to have been a forgery created by high-ranking priests of Yahweh who were becoming increasingly incensed at the popularity of competing cults. The Old Testament tells us that when the book was brought before King Josiah, he tore his robes because he realized for generations the people of the land had been angering Yahweh by worshiping other gods, particularly by burning incense to them. In regards to this, there may have been some political motivation, as Israel was seeking independence from their Assyrian overlords, and there may have been a desire to consolidate the kingdom. There was no real, delineated separation of church and state at this time, and in their competition for the devotion of the masses, the different religious cults were almost like bickering political parties, vying for power at times. The laws of Deuteronomy serve the basic purpose of getting rid of all the competing cults, along with their priests and priestesses. And the revision of the history of the area and its traditions to accomplish this goal was beyond Orwellian in its scope, as the Bible tells us of these monotheistic reforms.
And the king commanded Hilkiah the high priest to bring forth out of the temple of the Lord all the vessels that were made for Baal and for Asherah, and for all the hosts of heaven. And he burned them outside Jerusalem in the fields of Kidron. And he put down the idolatrous priests, whom the king of Judah had ordained to burn incense in the high places in the cities of Judah and the places round about Jerusalem. Them also that burned incense unto Baal, to the sun, and to the moon, and to the planets, and to all the hosts of heaven. And he brought out the Asherah from the house of the Lord outside Jerusalem, and burned it at the brook Kidron, and stamped it to small powder. And he brought out all the priests of the cities of Jerusalem, and defiled the high places where the priests had burned incense, and the high places that were before Jerusalem, which Solomon the king of Israel had builded for Ashtoreth, the abomination of the Zidonians, did the king defile. And he brake in pieces the images, and cut down the groves, and filled their places with the bones of men. And he slew all the priests of the high places that were upon the altars, and burned men's bones upon them, and returned to Jerusalem. Like unto him, there was no king before him that turned to the Lord with all his heart, and with all his soul, and with all his might, according to the law.
Now, what is interesting about these reforms is the book that initiated them was found in the temple of a polytheistic king, Solomon, and supposedly authored by Moses. However, according to the Old Testament, among the reforms that took place under a previous monotheistic reformer, Josiah's great-grandfather, Hezekiah, was the destruction not only of the pagan idols of Asherah and other deities, but the brazen serpent Moses had made.
He removed the high places, and break the images, and cut down the Asherahs, and break into pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. For unto those days the children of Israel did burn incense to it.
They were clearly burning a lot of incense in those days. Despite Josiah's best efforts at reforms and consolidation, however, Josiah was not rewarded by the Lord for his efforts, but rather died in battle as the Jewish people continued to fall victim to the more powerful kingdoms around them. As the Bible has it, it was during the reign of Josiah that a prophet who made the final reference to Cana received his calling from the Lord. Even according to the Old Testament, the people did not respond well to Jeremiah's criticism. Jeremiah was attacked by his own brothers, beaten and put into stocks by priests and competing prophets, imprisoned by the king, threatened with death, thrown into a cistern by Judah's officials. He was such an enemy of the ruling Jews and Jewish people of the time that when Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, seized Jerusalem in 586 BC, he ordered that Jeremiah be freed from prison and treated well. In the Old Testament's final reference to Cana, through the prophet Jeremiah, we see its former sanctity of the Exodus and Song of Songs references, along with the Lord's anger of not getting his due of it in Isaiah, turned to disdain and outright rejection.
as the Lord says through the prophet Jeremiah.
What do I care about incense from Sheba or Canna from a distant land? Your burnt offerings are not acceptable. Your sacrifices do not please me.
So here we see the formerly revered plant of the holy oil and incense become a foreign thorn in the side of Jewish worship. We can be sure that the association here is with the adulterous association of Canna with the cult of the goddess, from a later reference in the story of Jeremiah. After the Babylonian exile, when he preached the following sermon against exiled Jews in Egypt.
Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, ye have seen all the evil that I have brought upon Jerusalem and upon the cities of Judah, and behold, this day they are in a desolation, because of their wickedness, which they have committed to provoke me to anger, in that they wanted to burn incense and to serve other gods. Therefore now, wherefore commit ye this great evil against your souls, in that ye provoke me to wrath with the works of your hands, burning incense to other gods in the land of Egypt? Then all men which knew that their wives had burned incense unto other gods, and all the women that stood by, a great multitude, even all the people that dwelt in the land of Egypt, answered Jeremiah, saying, as for the word that thou hast spoken unto us in the name of the Lord, we will not hearken unto thee, but we will certainly do whatsoever goeth forth out of our own mouth, to burn incense unto the Queen of Heaven, and to pour drink offerings unto her, as we have done, and we and our fathers and our kings and our princes in the city of Judah and the streets of Jerusalem, for they have plenty and victuals, and were well, and saw no evil.
In their defense, the people arguing with Jeremiah had a good point, as even according to the biblical storyline, it was during periods of polytheism under kings like wise Solomon that the culture reached its zenith. Alternatively, under monotheistic reformers like Josiah and Hezekiah, the ancient Jews lost their grip and fell to the more powerful empires around them. The authors of the Bible, of course, explain this as punishment on the Jews for their sins of their fathers burning incense on high to Asherah, Baal, and other deities, and the victorious polytheistic cultures of Assyria and Babylon, who descended upon them, were just fulfilling God's will to punish the Israelites for their own polytheistic behavior, acting as God's hammer. The logic of this, of course, was an undeniably hard sell, as the crowd's response in Jeremiah shows. Indeed, after Babylon had invaded the Holy Land and sent a large portion of the people into exile, when Babylonian rule was supplanted by the new empire on the block, the Persians, who sent the descendants of the Jews back to their homeland a century later, polytheism was still the religion of the day in Israel and Judah. Some scholars suggest that before the Persians came onto the scene, monotheism had not even been a serious consideration in the Holy Land. This brings us to some interesting points in regards to the prophet Ezra, also known as Ezra the Scribe, a supposed descendant of a Jewish high priest who was raised and educated in Babylon. Ezra is said by tradition to have arranged the Old Testament books in their present order, rewritten parts, corrected, filled in details, as well as even composing some texts, such as parts of the book of Genesis, which would explain the obvious and well-known Babylonian and Assyrian influences on the Eden myth. The Persian Empire had not long prior to this itself converted to monotheism through the monotheistic reforms of their own formerly polytheistic empire via a cannabis-consuming prophet, Zoroaster. According to Mircea Eliade, one of the foremost authorities on the histories of religion, shamanic ecstasy induced by hemp was known in ancient Iran. Eliade has suggested that in the Avestan tradition, Zarathustra himself was believed to give himself over to ecstasy. As Professor Eliade and other respected religious scholars have long noted, textual evidence shows that Zoroaster and other key figures in the development of the Zoroastrian cosmology used hemp to bridge the metaphysical gap between heaven and earth. Indeed, the plant was of such importance to the ancient Zoroastrians that in the Zendavesta, hemp occupies the first place in a list of 10,000 medicinal plants. Zoroaster, like Moses, prohibited the orgiastic rites of polytheism and supplanted them with a monotheistic male-centered cult of laws and control. In the Persian case, this was Ahura Mazda,
and in the Semitic version, the one god was Yahweh. But both deities ascended to monotheism out of earlier polytheistic pantheons. In light of this, it is not at all surprising to find that it is here, after the Persians returned the descendants of the Jews exiled during the Babylonian period to their homeland, that biblical monotheism, as portrayed in the Old Testament, finally took hold. And this is a time period also indicated by current archaeological finds. The Book of Ezra describes how around 457 BC he led a group of Judean exiles living in Babylon to the city of their ancestors, Jerusalem. Upon arrival in Jerusalem, Ezra claims to have found the Jews surrounded by idol worshippers, intermarrying with the women of the land who were not Jewish, and knowing nothing of the one true God. The Book of Ezra describes how he reintroduced the newly edited and composed Torah, enforced its observance, forcibly prohibited the worship of other gods, and ethnically cleansed the community of mixed marriages. We find the Book of the Law in Ezra's possession about 150 years after the Babylonians sent the Jews into captivity, and we find him reading from the Holy Book for 7 days while the people listened and wept. More than a century earlier, the Temple of Jerusalem had been burned, and the natural presumption is the Jewish library was burned with it. Where did Ezra get the Book of the Law from which he read? Now, there are some important factors here regarding this. Just as earlier, it was noted that the biblical account of the monotheistic reforms of Josiah may have been inspired by a need to consolidate the kingdom in the face of foreign powers. So too did foreign empires have a desire to communicate with their vassal states via one central body. And more than a few scholars have suggested that this is what took place under Ezra, whose mission in the Holy Land was at the bequest of his Persian overlords, who, as noted, had not long before converted to their own form of monotheism. According to some scholars, for their renovation and revision of the area's religion, Ezra and the newly formed priesthood of Yahweh were rewarded with control of a temple state which collected taxes for Persia and from which they got a cut. In Persia and Creation of Judaism, Dr. M. D. McGee gives a detailed explanation of how Judaism was created by the Persians in 500 BC. McGee puts forth that part of the Persian policy of the restoration of the people back to their homelands included having the main male deity from each existing pantheon elevated to the same state as that of their own monotheistic god, Ahura Mazda, at the sacrifice of the powers of the gods and goddesses of the earlier pantheons. As McGee explains it, for reasons of political consolidation, the rulers wanted the people to worship one sole god, the concept being that everyone would worship a king of heaven with the same broad characteristics, but with different regional names. McGee suggests that evidence close to the time can be found in the words of the Egyptian Jew Philo of Alexandria, who lived about 20 BC to 50 AD, who wrote in his Vita Moses of the Torah, "Originally the laws were written in the Chaldean language." The Chaldean language was the dialect of Babylon at the time of Ezra, who was raised in Babylon and spoke it fluently. So the question arises as to why Moses, a Hebrew brought up in Egypt under a pharaoh like Ramses, would compose a Torah in a language of a distant country 800 years in the future. As Dr. McGee points out, Philo, an Egyptian Jew, effectively admits the Torah was written by Ezra, a Persian from Babylonia. Biblical commentators have long tried to explain this being due to the supposed Hebrew resettlers being raised in Babylon, were unfamiliar with Hebrew, so their holy book was given to them in another language. Dr. McGee is not at all alone in suggesting a Persian origin for Jewish monotheism, and it has been a matter of academic debate for more than a century, As noted more than 100 years ago by the very astute 19th century scholar George W. Brown in his researches in Oriental history. It was the law of Judea by virtue of Persian authority when Ezra decided to write the history of the world from the beginning, shall we say, copied the holy books from Ashurbanipal's library, duplicates of some of them, with the story of creation, the fall of man, the general deluge, the Tower of Babel, and the confusion of language are now on file in the British Museum, written on earthen plates, in cuneiform characters, under the direction of a Babylonian priest. Here is Ezra's own account of the process of making Jewish history. Interestingly, as we shall look at shortly, Brown and others have suggested that Ezra is describing the consumption of a psychoactive beverage. After telling the people not to seek him for 40 days, and taking with him 5 scribes who could swiftly write down what came out of his mouth, Ezra is reported to have made the following statement in regards to the source of his divine inspiration.
And the next day, behold, a voice called me, saying, Esdras, open your mouth and drink what I give you to drink. Then I opened my mouth, and behold, he handed me a full cup, which was full, as it were, with water, but the color of it was like fire. And I took it and drank, and when I had drunk of it, my heart uttered understanding, and wisdom grew in my breast, for my spirit strengthened my memory, and my mouth opened and shut no more. The highest gave understanding unto 5 men, and they wrote wonderful visions of the night. They were told of that which they had not known, and they sat for 40 days, and they wrote in that day and in that night. As for me, I spoke in the day, and I held not my tongue by night. In 40 days they wrote 204 books, and it came to pass, when 40 days were filled, the highest spoke, saying, the first that you have written, publish openly. And I did so.
Interestingly, George W. Brown, in his researches in Oriental history, put forth the true inspiration for much of the Old Testament's final rendition may have been derived from a cup of the Persian Haoma. We apprehend the reader is anxious to know the contents of the cup, which possessed such wondrous ability. Probably the same possessed by the fruit of the tree which grew in the midst of the garden, the eating of which opened the eyes of our first parents, enabled them to see as gods knowing good and evil. We think we can furnish this desired information, to do so which we are compelled to anticipate some facts existing among Zoroastrian worshippers, many centuries before the date religionists ascribed to Abraham, and which was practiced in Persia, Assyria, and Babylonia at the very time Ezra was writing Jewish history under the influence of the fiery cup. Among other duties required on occasional sacrifices to Ahura Mazda was the performance from time to time of a curious ceremony known as the Haoma or Homa. This consisted of the extraction of the juice of the Haoma plant by the priest during the recitation of prayers, the formal presentation of the liquid extracted to the sacrificial fire, the consumption of a small portion of it by one of the officiating ministers, and the division of the remainder among the worshippers. What was the Haoma or Homa, the production of the moon plant growing in those regions of Asia too far north for the successful growing of the grape, and yet yielding such intoxicating properties? It is known in the medical books and belongs to the Indian hemp family, Cannabis indica being an official preparation from it. It is now known in India as bhang and is popularly known with us as hashish, the stimulating and intoxicating effects of which are well known to physicians. The extract from its young and tender top has a fragrant odor and a warm, bitterish, and acrid taste. The adoration paid to the prepared juice of this plant and its use on sacrificial occasions, and the drinking of it by the high priest Ezra as he was about to open his mouth, while the 5 swift scribes wrote down his words when he was filled with the wisdom and understanding and was about to dictate history from the beginning of the world, can best be appreciated by members of the medical profession who have personally experienced its exhilarating effects on some fellow student who was elevated by his own estimation on a high pedestal and was capable of taking in all that has been, is, and may be in the material universe, Indeed, an acquaintance with this fact explains all those graphic descriptions in that celebrated history of the creation of the world, of the making of man, and of woman in particular, their expulsion from the garden, not forgetting that interesting interview with the snake, the materialized form of Angru Manus, or in our vernacular, the devil, the account of the deluge, Noah's drunken debauchery, Lot's wife changed into a pillar of salt, and the widower's escapade with his daughter, Jacob wrestling with God, getting a broken thigh, and seeing angels ascending and descending a ladder to and from heaven, the terrible plagues on Egypt, the parting of the Red Sea, the law passed down through a cloud to Moses by God himself, the adventures of Samson with the foxes, his contest with the lion, and the loss of his hair, David with his sling, the Hebrew boys in the fiery furnace, not omitting Jonah's wonderful gourd, nor his fishing exploits, Elijah's ride to heaven, and Elisha's children eating bears. No criticisms are required when it is known what kind of drink Ezra was regaled with before opening his mouth to dictate the history for his swift scribes to write. Interestingly, Brown's theory on the identity of Haoma may have been borne out in a modern archaeological find.
Russian archaeologist named Victor Sarianidi, the author of Margiana and Proto-Zoroastrianism, did some very interesting archaeological work in Turkmenistan. What Sarianidi did was he was investigating the myths of Soma and the temples of Margiana, which was the Greek name for northern Iran. And Margiana and Bactria were linked archaeologically by all kinds of finds, Bactria being further east and just north of Afghanistan, in the northern part of Afghanistan. So throughout this Bactria-Margiana complex, Sarianidi did some excavations, and he discovered several different fortified walled temples in Margiana and Bactria. What Sarianidi discovered was that there were several rooms in these temple complexes which were set apart from the main worshiping areas. And these were apparently manufacturing areas where the drugs that they were taking were manufactured. The drug was called Soma, or Haoma, in Iran. He dug into these archaeological temples, and he discovered that several of the rooms contained huge vats which were sealed to the floor so they couldn't be moved, and they were lined with gypsum, which would be a sealer for the inside of the vats. And he was able to get scraped samples off the bottom of these urns and submit them for analysis, and they discovered that the pollen grains, which had been preserved, consisted of ephedra and cannabis, and in some cases poppies. Poppies pollen was found in little pipes that they think were actually used for poppy. Perhaps even opium, but uncertain.
Deep in the Karakum Desert in Central Asia, a previously unknown Bronze Age civilization has been discovered. It was believed that there had never been human occupation in this desert until the archaeologist Victor Sarianidis started working here in Turkmenistan 40 years ago. Here in Gunur Tepe, ancient ritual practices have been identified, such as preparation of hallucinogenic ritual drinks.
So what he discovered was that Soma was probably made out of ephedra and cannabis and poppy in some mixture. And the reason I mention that is part is the idea of ephedra. Now, ephedra has been worshipped in many societies. He also discovered that ephedra is the source of ephedrine, which in modern days is used to make speed, methadrine, and which has therefore been banned in many countries, including Canada and the United States. And ephedra itself would be a minor stimulant that would keep people awake and worshipful, and would excite the people as well as transcending to a higher consciousness. So Sarianidi concludes that the Soma of the India and the Soma, the Haoma of ancient Iran was probably a mixture of ephedra, cannabis, and poppy that was even possibly fermented, although there's a great deal of argument about that. and then was handed out in the public rooms of these temple sanctuaries and drunk by the people in the form of a libation. And then they would have all-night singing and dancing festivals. It's a very interesting progression then across the Middle East from Soma originally, and the idea of using potions that were made out of cannabis in order to induce transcendental states, higher states of consciousness.
It has been suggested that Zoroaster prohibited the Haoma rites, although the Haoma ritual returned to later Zoroastrianism. Having looked over the material regarding this relationship at great length, as discussed in my book, Cannabis and the Soma Solution, it seems to me what was prohibited was the orgiastic rites surrounding the use of Haoma, as well as the use of cannabis in the concoction, at least for the common folks. However, references to cannabis as Zoroaster's good narcotic in the Vendidad and its use for purposes of revelation under his guidance shows that a restricted use of cannabis continued. This situation would explain both the continued use of ephedra in modern Haoma preparations, as well as Zoroaster's use of cannabis-infused wine and or Haoma for the initiation of the priestly elites and kings, in the same way the anointing oil and incense were prohibited to all but the Jewish elite. A look at these Zoroastrian references gives us some interesting insights into Ezra's cup of fire, as they refer specifically to cannabis-infused wine or mixed with Haoma as a means of religious revelation. The Persian story has it that Zoroaster wandered the countryside for 10 years without winning over the people to his new religious concepts. It was not until he met King Vishtaspa, who converted to Zoroaster's religion after drinking a cup of potent cannabis extract mixed with wine, that the Iranian prophet's belief began to take hold on a wide scale. Apparently, Zoroaster's wife, Hovovi, was not satisfied with only a secondary account of the shamanic experience, and after hearing about Zoroaster's visions, she prayed to the Supreme Being that Zoroaster give her his good narcotic, Bhanga. Darmestetter mentions the Zoroastrian psychonaut Ardu Viraf, a figure widely credited with bringing to the world many of the concepts of heaven and hell, an act again accomplished through means of a vision via cannabis infused in wine or Haoma. In his article, Preparations for Visions in Second Temple Jewish Apocalyptic Literature, Vincent Dubaraka also noted a comparison between the Persian techniques of shamanic ecstasy and that of Ezra. Dubaraka revisited this theme in more detail in his later 2006 article, Chemically Induced Visions in the Fourth Book of Ezra in Light of Comparative Persian Material, and again draws direct comparison between Ezra's cup of fire and the cannabis-mixed infused beverages of the Zoroastrian psychonauts. Dubaraka also compared Ezra's chemically induced inspiration to Ezekiel's eating of the scroll referred to earlier. It should also be noted Scythians, who had extensive cultural connections to both Hebrew and the Persians, were known to drink cannabis-infused beverages from fiery cups made to resemble the braziers they burnt cannabis in. In the account of Ezra drinking from the cup of fire, one is clearly reminded of the tradition of fiery cups among the Scythians, but even more so of the Zoroastrian accounts of the drinking of cannabis mixed with Haoma or wine. Interestingly, Emanuel Lo referred to an ancient Jewish Passover recipe that called for wine to be mixed with ground-up saffron and hassisitz hurer, which he saw as a kind of deck name for the resin of cannabis sativa, as we've already mentioned. Such preparations were also noted by other 19th century biblical scholars.
About the wines being suffused with a variety of drugs, first of all, the wines could not have produced the intoxication, especially when diluted with water, that are documented. So it pretty much is accepted now that there were additives to the wine.
Cannabis-infused wines were hugely popular throughout the ancient world, being utilized in Greece, Persia, among the Scythians, along with Egypt, where cannabis pollen has been found in ancient wine amphora, and China, where a wine-cannabis mix served as our first anesthetic. In the Mideast, cannabis-infused wines were used by Islamic mystics up until near modern times. Prior to Ezra, there was no collection of books known as the Torah, and allegedly he gathered together what texts of his forefathers he could find from throughout the land, and together with a group of scribes under his charge began editing, rewriting, filling in the blanks, and in many areas outright creating the books we now know as the Old Testament. It seems likely he did this under the request of his Persian overlords, utilizing the same source of ecstasy they did for their own revelation, cannabis infused in wine or mixed with haoma. In this respect, it is interesting to know that Darius, accredited in the Bible for his help for the return of the Jews to the Holy Land and in licensing the building of the Second Temple, is believed to have been the son of Vishtaspa. The Zoroastrian king, Zoroaster himself, is said by tradition to have converted to monotheism with a cup of cannabis-infused wine or haoma. The whole history of the Bible is called into question by this. Indeed, other than the Bible itself, there is no archaeological or historical evidence for figures like Moses and kings like Saul, David, Solomon. Even Josiah's name is nowhere to be found other than in the Old Testament and related literature. Moreover, the archaeological record clearly indicates polytheism in practice in the area throughout the whole period. In this sense, it is not hard to see the whole Old Testament as a collection of myths and history from the bickering southern kingdom of Judah and northern kingdom of Israel stitched together with a new monotheistic overview, complete with myths to justify its creation. Monotheistic revisioning of the religion of Israel was obviously fraught with consequences. From Karl Rucks' description of the Second Temple Yom Kippur ritual, it is hard not to see it as a bastardized version of the Hieros Gamos, or sacred marriage, as described earlier, complete with a transvestite priest playing the role of the goddess or high priestess.
I love these fancified redrawings of the holy moment. The high priest, each year on Yom Kippur, this is no longer done because the temple doesn't exist, but on Yom Kippur, he entered the confined, enclosed space of the inner tabernacle of the temple in Jerusalem with a burning brazier of the aromatic incense. And there, Yahweh materialized to him amidst the smoke upon the altar of the Ark of the Covenant. As the personification of Israel, the high priest offered himself as bride to the deity, reaffirming the covenant. This is, of course, radical patriarchal revisionism of a worship of the goddess. Now the priest, a man, dresses as a woman and impersonates the nation and marry Yahweh. The original Ark of the Covenant underwent considerable alteration since the time of Moses and the Israelites wandering in the desert. Once it had two angels atop it, copulating. The Ark in the temple in Jerusalem was a pious forgery, and the angels had been separated by a decent interval. But to mask the embarrassment about the mere existence of a graven image, the Jewish Neoplatonist Philo significantly claimed there was so much smoke inside the tabernacle that the priest couldn't see anything anyway, so who knows what they were copulating.
Of the books that have been suggested as either a tribute to or reworked from earlier accounts by Ezra and his scribes, or possibly by earlier monotheistic reformers going back to the time of Hezekiah and Josiah, Nothing has held more consequence for humanity as a whole as the myths of the fabled Garden of Eden, still believed by millions to this day as the gospel truth about humanity's origins, despite the fact that it was one of the later books composed in the Old Testament, and a clear reversal of earlier Mideast stories of creation. I would suggest that the myth of Adam and Eve and the forbidden fruit is the most powerful myth in the history of humanity, particularly the way it has affected the status of women in our society for thousands of years, and has demonized the pursuit of knowledge, as well as leading the way for our modern paradigm of prohibition.
Adam and Eve were busted because whatever they ate, and there's lots of candidates for what they ate, and all of them could be the right one, you know, and remembering it was a myth, and there wasn't any Adam and Eve and any drug, but at some point, it's the prohibition myth, and it's a God who is like the enforcer. And the reason God comes down on them so heavily is that they once they took the substance, the fruit of the tree, they felt like gods themselves. And I guess God didn't want to be supplanted. But having God-like experiences. Also in that myth, of course, is the serpent, the drug dealer, the pusher. But it's also, the serpent is also the shaman, the holy man who introduces the substance, the plant, to the first people. The history of prohibition, it really follows this, and of course it's tied into everything else. It's especially tied into economics, but it's tied into, there's so much spiritual competition.
What can the Eden myth tell us about the ancient Hebrews?
The myth becomes a matrix that holds scientific clues from the society, about the society that you're studying. And one of the scientific clues that we can look at is, how do they use specific drugs?
I think we can now safely say what drugs the ancient Jews were using, and I would also suggest this myth is indicative of their prohibition, at least to the common man and woman. In earlier Mesopotamian versions of the myth, the tree of life and the tree of knowledge are the same tree. It is only in the Genesis account they are separated. Further, they are given to humanity for their benefit, not prohibited to keep people ignorant. The Eden myth brings some interesting points to mind in regards to what we now know about temple worship in Jerusalem, as so much of the symbolism is shared between the two. There were the cherubims on the Ark of the Covenant and the cherubim which guarded the way to Eden. There is the serpent, and then there was the serpent Moses made, which the people burned incense to, which was destroyed in the reforms of Hezekiah for that reason. Moses has other connections with a serpent besides making the bronze serpent. He turned his staff into a serpent and back again to demonstrate the power of his magic. And the priestly caste created by Moses, the tribe of Levi, was derived from the same verbal root as the word Leviathan, a great serpent that appears in the Old Testament. As well, the name Seraphim, he who lifted the coal with tongs to Isaiah's lips, means fiery serpent. Some have even suggested that originally, the Hebrew act of tribal body modification, known as circumcision, was to give the male sex organ the appearance of a serpent, and the removal of the foreskin a symbolic shedding of its skin like the snake does. Even the symbol of the tree was present as a menorah, which some scholars believe is there as a replacement for Asherah's symbol of the tree of life, which once sat inside the temple in Jerusalem. The Assyrian and Babylonian influences on the Bible are clear, and as a scribe during the exile, Ezra would have likely been familiar with the myths of the prototypical Garden of Eden and the Flood recorded there. The Mesopotamian accounts generally involved an ancient god known under various location names as Ea, Enki, Ones, and some suggest the Canaanite Dagon. Interestingly, this figure, known as the crafty god, has not only been seen as the prototype of the biblical serpent, but also as a deity whose stories and attributes, like those of the Canaanite god El, contributed to the development of the identity of Israel's one god, Yahweh. A possibility I've looked at more in depth in my book, Sex, Drugs, Violence, and the Bible. The ancient texts record that the roots of the Kiskano tree reached into the abyss and its branches stretched to the heavens. Like the Persian Haoma, the Kiskano tree held both sacramental and medicinal qualities. The second part of the name of this notable tree, Kiskanu, has phonetic similarities with the early names for cannabis through the linguistic root can, which is found in various cannabis-related words. Apparently, it was quite prevalent, as the ancient texts refer to the Kiskanu, which grows like a grove. This also brings to mind the groves associated with Asherah in the Old Testament, which were cut down during monotheistic reforms. Referring to the incantation text regarding the Kiskanu, R. Campbell Thompson described, "This document indicated to the magician who was about to treat his afflicted patient that a certain kind of plant or tree, the original which grew in Eridu and contained magical qualities, and acting on this information, the magician was directed to make use of a potion of the Kiskanu tree on behalf of the said patient. The text actually states the gods themselves made use of this plant to work a miracle of healing, and the implication is that the Kiskanu plant was on this occasion of great benefit. It may again be made to perform the healing of a sufferer, provided the suitable words of power were recited and appropriate ceremonies were performed before the plant itself was used as a remedy." As Ea was the god associated with the Kiskanu tree, it is interesting to note that in the Assyrian sacred rites, an offering of fine oil, wax, sweet aromatics, myrrh, and cannabis were among the gifts offered to Ea. This brings to mind the image of the Assyrian sacred rites. We see in this central image a holy plant or tree of some sort, unidentifiable with any particular botanical species. No known ancient inscriptions describe what this image represents, although since the 19th century, it has been identified as both the tree of life and also the Persian Haoma by a number of different researchers. Likewise, no known depiction of cannabis have been identified in ancient Assyrian art, although by all accounts it was a very important plant to the Assyrians, who used it as a food source for fiber, as a medicine and in edibles, and as a topical ointment and incense to aid in the rapport with God. They particularly used it in the sacred rites as an offering to the god Ea, and so an association seems plausible. Perhaps the pine cone-like items held over the sacred tree and the king are indications of a rite involving the Kiskanu tree or the tree of life, and perhaps the ritual sprinklings of the Kiskanu myth is a reference to the actual cannabis ointments used in both Assyria and the Exodus account to aid in the communion with God. In the 19th century, George Rawlinson noted of the pine cone-like buds of the Assyrian tree of life that it is though it were a medium of communication between the protector and the protected, the instrument by means of which grace and power passed from the genius to the mortal which he had under his care. As Rawlinson's contemporary, Francis Lenormant, noted, often it is held under the king's nose that he may breathe it. A scribe of the Assyrian king Ashurbanipal recorded in 650 BC, "We were dead dogs, but our lord the king gave us life by placing the herb of life beneath our noses." The reason that this connection has not been noted before may be due to the fact that in the ancient Near East, matters involving religious and technical methods were considered closely guarded secrets. Professor H.W.F. Sags noted that the text dealing with such matters ended with the instructions such as, "Let the initiate show the initiate, the non-initiate shall not see it. It belongs to the tabooed things of the great gods." Such holy knowledge was either only passed along verbally and not committed to writing, or were written in a manner which was deliberately obscure. The image of the tree of life and its divine association with the king, as well as the use of cannabis as a holy incense and entheogen, both fall into such a category. This is another subject more thoroughly looked at in Sex, Drugs, Violence, and the Bible, where it was suggested that even the baskets held by the Birdmass shaman were likely made from the fibers of the sacred tree itself. Indeed, what was the first thing Adam and Eve did after partaking of the forbidden fruit in the Eden myth but weave clothes? Interestingly, the eagle-headed figures which often surround the sacred tree have been compared to both the cherubim, who guard the way of the tree of life in Eden, and the Garuda, who guarded the Soma in Aryan myths that made it to India, by Assyrian scholar Francis Lenormant, who was the first to suggest the Assyrian symbol was the Mesopotamian tree of life and Persian Haoma. Such an adoption of the figure, most frequently used to represent the sacred tree of the Chaldeans and Assyrians on the part of the Persians to signify Haoma, though bearing no resemblance whatsoever to the genuine plant, proves that they recognize a certain analogy in the conception of these two emblems. In fact, adaptions of this nature were made with great discrimination by the Persians. The adoption of the Chaldean and Assyrian tree to represent Haoma, therefore, shows decisively that it was possible to trace some kinship between these symbols. In the Assyrian base reliefs, the sacred plant is guarded by winged genii with the heads of eagles. There is a singular analogy between these symbolic beings and the Garudas of the Aryans in India, genii half men and half eagles. In the Indian myths, it is the Garuda who recover the ambrosia or sacred juice of Soma, with which the libations were made, giving it back to the celestial gods. The Garuda is made its keeper. His office, therefore, as well as the eagle-headed genie of the Assyrian monument beside the plant of life, is similar to the duty ascribed in Genesis to the cherubim, which Yahweh placed in the Garden of Eden after driving forth of the first human pair to defend the entrance and to keep the way of the tree of life. Other compelling connections are indicated by other depictions of the Assyrian sacred tree, referring to the image of the Ur moon god Nannar seated with the sacred tree across from the goddess. Sir Wallace Budge noted, "He holds in his outstretched hands a reed or rod, a loop of cord, and a circular object made of cords or reeds, which are tied round with a cord. What this object is unknown. In his left hand, the god holds a digging tool. The two clusters of fruit which hang over the sides of the vase may be intended to represent clusters of dates, but I cannot think that they have anything to do with the tree. It seems to me that it represents some grain-producing plants, perhaps wheat, which supplied both gods and men with food. It is clearly a plant closely associated with and sacred to the god." Budge came very close, but unfortunately seemed unaware of the profound role of cannabis in the ancient world. With the association of a fiber plant, which also produces a food for both gods and men, alongside what we now know of the use of cannabis in the sacred rites of the time, a stronger case for the hemp plant can be made than any sort of other grain-producing plant. And here again we are reminded of a Persian name for cannabis in use around this period, Sahadanag, which means royal grain, as noted by Rabbi Emmanuel Lowe. And sometime after the Persian Empire took control of the ancient world, the Jews adopted this name for a preparation which contained cannabis seeds. In the case of the Assyrian tree of life, it was used as a symbol in ceremonies that we now know involved cannabis, which used it as both an incense and ointment to aid in the rapport with God.
Regardless of which sacred drug plant may have been symbolized by the apple, it was a controlled substance, and eating it resulted in the first drug bust of prehistory, for which Eve has borne the responsibility and the blame. Some view the Eden myth as a patriarchal cover-up and suppression of the goddess religions which preceded it. The figure of Eve, a diabolicized view of woman, and more importantly, the goddess in the ancient world. Quote, "Originally Eve was not Adam's wife, but his mother. She was not a human, but a goddess, and the outcome was not tragic, but triumphant. After the magic fruit was eaten, Adam himself became a god. What was originally involved was probably a psychedelic sacrament, like the Eleusinian festival in Athens, in which the worshippers ate certain hallucinogenic foods and became one with the mother goddess," end quote, Robert Anton Wilson.
In respect to the more local tradition of canon and those indigenous influences already in the Holy Land, it is also important to remember that Asherah, whose cultic use of cannabis in incense and ointments has been noted, as well as her cult's practice of ritual weaving in the temple, was herself recognized through her symbol of the Tree of Life.
An ancient ivory cosmetic casket lid from the 14th century site of Minet el-Bidia, that's 14th century BC, depicts the goddess herself in the role of the Tree of Life, offering two caprids vegetation which closely resemble buds of cannabis. Quote, "This depiction seems to indicate finally the explanation of the biblical reference to the Asherah as a natural or stylized tree in the fertility cult. This was the symbol of the mother goddess, now known from the Ras Shamra text as Asherah. The tree of life is called Asherah in the Old Testament, end quote, Professor John Gray. Icons dedicated to Asherah have depictions of a sacred tree or plant, most likely made as a visual reference to the hemp that her followers grew and revered, utilizing it as an entheogen, but also as a food and oil source, along with using its fibers in ritual weavings.
The association of the goddess with the tree of life was apparently as widespread as her association with cannabis incenses and ointments. It was Ishtar who was said to have first planted the tree of life, and it was Ishtar, goddess of love and war, who granted kingship. It seems likely that Asherah's relationship with the sacred tree or bush was a development of this earlier connection. Perhaps the Old Testament references to cutting down Asherah's groves during monotheistic reforms were references to the destruction of a crop of her sacred plant, cannabis. In light of Asherah's recognition as a symbol of the sacred tree and her cult's use of cannabis, it is of interest to note that in medieval times, certain Muslim groups referred to cannabis by the name Asherah, seen by them as an endearing term for their hempen girlfriend. A tradition likely carried on from the earlier association of the ancient goddess and the tree of life in the form of cannabis. That the use of the word in this context can be correlated to the ancient world usage is very probable. A number of ancient words are still present in its vocabulary. A fine example is the more commonly used name for cannabis, kanabu. Further, cannabis was being consumed in beverage form in the Mideast as haoma up until at least the 19th century. Of course, in regards to the identity of the original forbidden trees of the Eden myth, we are left to speculation. However, in regards to the role of cannabis among the ancient Jews, less so. And I think you would agree a much stronger case can be made for the use of cannabis in the holy oil, incenses, and cup of fire. I would say that the implications this information holds about the plant-based shamanic origins of the Judeo-Christian traditions is on par with the challenges that Darwin's theory of evolution has presented to the myths of Genesis, in that they demonstrate the evolution of biblical ideas and thought via plant-based shamanism. A technique of shamanic ecstasy believers in the Bible have moved to ban and destroy whenever they have come into contact with it. From the beginning of the Dark Ages, when pagan cultures who utilized sacred plants were prohibited and destroyed, along to medieval witches burnt alive for their use, and into the New World where peyote, mushroom, and other plant-based cultures were driven into non-existence, right down to our modern war on drugs, which has its origins in Christian concepts of the devil's weed and the prohibition of the forbidden fruit. Further, the suppression of goddess worship at the core of the myth has been the rape and murder of the divine feminine and has resulted in millennia of religious-based misogyny, not to mention the biblically idealized couple of Adam and Eve as being the role model argument against homosexuality, when throughout much of the ancient Mideast prior to the rise of monotheism, homosexuals were considered sacred figures, the Quetishun of the Jerusalem temple, who were much like the two-spirited people of indigenous North American culture. Biblical law saw them suffer death at the hands of the faithful over and over again. Indeed, the term faggot comes from the faggots of wood, which many were burnt over well into medieval times. Thus, in closing this considerable presentation on the material that helps to document the role of this now forbidden plant in the Bible itself, as well as revealing so many of the Bible's long-hidden secrets, I find myself saying, as did the serpent before me, when it sat up high on the branches of the forbidden tree of knowledge, watching contentedly as Adam and Eve ate of its fruit. "So," it hissed, "how do you like them apples?"